Thank you. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Union Church of Los Angeles Combined English Language Worship Service. We're so glad to have you on this Sunday morning. Those of you on Zoom, please silence your devices. Thank you. And for our prelude, I'll be playing It Came Upon a Midnight Clear.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to Union Church. Welcome if you're an old member and have been here for years. Welcome if you're new to joining us this morning. We're so glad you're here with us. Recently, I had the opportunity to go back to Okinawa with my mom, and I was reminded of one of the aspects of Okinawan culture that I'm so grateful to have, so grateful to be blessed with. And that's the sense that when you are part of an island community, you become family right away because your lives depend on each other. You need each other. And so, you know, every culture has its proverbs, and I think I've probably shared this proverb with you before, but it's ichari bachode in the Okinawan language. And what that means is once we've met, we're siblings. So literally, once we've met, we treat each other like family, and I so love that about Okinawan culture, but I love that even more because I think it reflects kingdom culture. It reflects church culture, and that's the way we're supposed to be. We're supposed to be family to each other because indeed we're tied by not only the blood of Christ, but the image of God. So this morning, again, whether you're an old member or a new member, welcome. I'm going to read Psalm 72, 1 through 7 as our call to worship, to set our minds kind of in the right context, in the right place as we enter service today. So I encourage you to bow your hearts, maybe close your eyes, listen to these words from Scripture. I'm going to read them slowly and allow yourself to marinate in these words. Endow the king with your justice, O God, the royal son with your righteousness. May he judge your people in righteousness, your afflicted ones with justice. May the mountains bring prosperity to the people, the hills the fruit of righteousness. May he defend the afflicted among the people and save the children of the needy. May he crush the oppressor. May he endure as long as the sun, as long as the moon, through all generations. May he be like rain falling on a mown field, like showers watering the earth. In his days, may the righteous flourish and prosperity abound till the moon is no more. continue to bow your hearts with me in prayer. Oh God Almighty, it's with hearts of gratitude that we come before you as family this morning to learn from you, to sit at your feet, to be loved by you. But it's also our privilege to come and offer our love and our lives and our community to you and to your service. Bless our time here this morning together. In your name we pray. Amen. So we have the honor and privilege this morning of having our Advent candle lit, our second week of Advent. And so I want to invite Atsuki and Maria and their two young beautiful kids up as they come up and share a reading as well as light the candle.
We light this candle to proclaim the coming of the light of God into the world. With the coming of this light, there is peace. For Christ is called the Prince of Peace. For Christ is also named as Emmanuel, God with us. The presence of Christ gives us this peace today and always. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much. At this time, please stand if you are able and join in singing our opening song as Jubilee leads us in 10,000 Reasons.
10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Oh, bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Near and my time has come. Still, my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore, we sing. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. So we sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I worship Your holy name. We sing, bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh, my soul. Oh, my soul, worship Your holy name. Your holy name, I will worship Your holy name.
Thank you.
Come on, let's send that attitude of worship, and let's ask God this morning, as we consider the coming of Christ to change us, to bring peace from the inside out. Amen.
From the inside, from the inside of me, may You delight on the inside, on the inside of me. Come fill my life from the inside. From the inside of me, set me on fire. From the inside, from the inside of me, 'cause all I want. Inside of me, just come fill my life from the inside, from the inside of me. Send me on fire from the inside, from the inside of me. 'Cause all I want is for you to be glorified, for you to be lifted high. All I want is for you to be glorified, for you to be lifted high. All I want is for you to be glorified, for you to be lifted high. Fill my life till all they see is you, Lord. Glorify your name. Fill my life till all they see is you, Lord. Glorify your name. Fill my life till all they see is you, Lord. Glorify your name. 'Cause all I want is for you to be glorified, for you to be lifted high. All I want is for you to be glorified, for you to be lifted. All I want is for you to be glorified, for you to be lifted high. All I want is for you to be glorified, for you to be lifted high. Let praises rise from the inside, from the inside.
Let praises rise from the inside of me. May you delight in the inside of me. Lord, we bless that song, and we're blessed by it, and would you allow that song to become a reality in our lives, where we don't seek for ourselves to be elevated, ourselves to be lifted, but you to be lifted. Would you continue with me in prayer as we pray together as a community? I'll read the one, and if you would all read together the all. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon.
Where there is discord, harmony. Where there is error, truth. Where there is doubt, faith.
Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy.
Eternal Prince of Peace, may we not only seek to be consoled, but also to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love.
For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. And it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Brother Keith. Join us in our opening hymn, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. Triumph of the skies with angelic hosts proclaim Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Christ the highest heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord, late in time. The Godhead see, held incarnate deity, pleased as man as man to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more.
So this is the time where we're going to pass the peace. And if you don't know what that means, if you're not from kind of a liturgical tradition, passing the peace basically means that you're going to greet each other, we're going to greet one another, and bless each other with peace. And sometimes that might be in passing, and it might take just 5 seconds. Other times it may take a minute or two before you reconnect. So, you know, this is a time, this is a liberal time for us to connect with each other here. And so please greet each other this morning and bless each other with peace. All right, so as we, you know, as we get larger, as people come back, as we have new members, obviously that's gonna take longer and longer. So my word to you is get used to it. You know, get, in Hawaii, If you go to church there, many churches that have this time of greeting, it'll take 10, 15 minutes where you're greeting people. And so this is not meant to just be kind of a wave to somebody across the, you know, across the sanctuary kind of time. It's really meant to be, since many of us don't have the privilege of seeing each other regularly, it's really meant to be a time of incorporating a little bit of connection into the service. So this morning, we are going to have a special guest via Zoom read to us. Bob? Good morning, Bob.
Good morning.
Bob's going to read our scripture.
Good morning, everyone. In those days, John the Baptist came preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is he who was spoken of through the prophet Isaiah, a voice of one calling in the wilderness, "Prepare the way for the Lord, make straight paths for him." John's clothes were made of camel's hair, and he had a leather belt around his waist. His food was locusts and wild honey. People went out to him from Jerusalem and all Judea and the whole region of the Jordan. Confessing their sins, they were baptized by him in the Jordan River. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to where he was baptizing, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the coming wrath? Produce fruit in keeping with repentance. And do not think that you can say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' I tell you that out of these stones, God can raise up children for Abraham. The axe is already at the root of the tree, and every tree that does not produce good fruit will be cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but after me comes one who is more powerful than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor, gathering his wheat into the barn and burning up the chaff with unquenchable fire. This is the word of the Lord."
Thanks be to God. So I'm going to say a little prayer for our pastor before he brings the word to us. So Father in heaven, thank you so much for our brother. Would you bless and anoint his preparation, the words that come out of his mouth. And Lord, would you soften our hearts to receive your word, receive hope, to receive encouragement, to receive challenge this morning. Amen.
Thank you so much. Hey, amen. I know we've passed the peace already, but one more time, can you turn to your neighbor and just tell him it's good to see him in the house of the Lord this morning? Amen. We are in our Advent season. It's a season where we're really reorienting and refocusing our attention and our gaze. It's so good to see the church decorated. And in front of the altar here, we have our Advent wreath. And for the next 4 weeks, as we prepare our hearts for the arrival of Jesus Christ, we're centering our attention on these four pillars, these four principles that really should become synonymous with what it means for Christ to come into the world, for the incarnation of the mystery of God, for the coming of Christ again, for the arrival of Christ in the heart of every believer. The first candle that we lit was the candle of hope. Today's candle is the candle of peace. Next Sunday is the candle of joy. And finally, the fourth candle is the candle of love. These four pillars around our Advent calendars are supposed to remind us and guide us. And so as we come to church every Sunday, we're going to be focusing on what this means in light of the scriptures we read. And again, the scriptures that are being selected for our reading are scriptures that have been used for hundreds and hundreds of years, that the church said, this is synonymous with what it means to have hope. Again, some of these passages may not feel like low-hanging fruit. The passage we just read about John the Baptist speaking the words of preparation for the Messiah may seem like an odd fit to talk about peace. But I want to weave it together today. And as we get into the Word of God this morning, I want to somewhat set the stage historically for this passage and for what it meant for Jesus to begin his ministry. Many of us know that during the time in which Jesus arrived, Jerusalem, Judea, that area was an occupied territory. The Roman Empire had established its power, its reign over that region, and the locals, quote unquote, were not very happy about it. Ethnic Jewish people, ethnic Sumerians had this oppressive empire that was dictating from Rome what happens in Jerusalem, what happens in Samaria, what happens in that region. If you go to the Holy Land now, you'll see all these wonderful layers of history in the architecture. And so the Jewish people had been longing for a homeland from the time in which Abraham went out with this promise from God that I will bless you, I will give you a land, I will make you great. From the time in which David and Solomon sought to build a temple for God, from the time in which the prophets said there's coming a time where God's going to bless you on this earth, they were pregnant with anticipation. Advent means the arrival, the coming, the anticipation. The people of Israel in that time, they were not just expectant, they were also a little bit annoyed, perturbed, right? It's Sunday morning, so I won't use a stronger word, but they were angry. They were ticked off because here are these Romans telling the Jewish people, telling the people of that community where to go, when and where to worship, when and where to live. So this passage of scripture comes at a time that Jerusalem, Judea is occupied, and enter the prophet John the Baptist. John the Baptist, who said, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is here. Repent." And he comes proclaiming a message that is very much shock and awe, a message that is provocative in nature. If you can put the passage up one more time, Inho. We look at this passage of scripture, and this passage of scripture gives us a vision of John the Baptist as a precursor to the message of Jesus. And this message is not a very harmonious message, is it? It's pretty much calling out all the powers that be and saying, get ready because someone is coming that's going to bring a reckoning to our status. It is believed that most of John the Baptist's disciples were ready for a political revolution. They wanted peace, not just on earth. They wanted peace in terms of liberation from the occupying forces. They wanted a very, very different reality to be here on earth. And this morning, I want to take some time to compare and contrast the ministry of John the Baptist and the ministry of Jesus. And if you will follow me throughout the book of Matthew, it's really important for us to understand the tension that existed between John the Baptist's ministry and the tension that was with Jesus's ministry. Because John the Baptist was preaching the same thing Jesus was preaching. One of the first messages that Jesus gives in the temple in Luke chapter 4, he says this: repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Here we see that the very first thing John the Baptist is saying, he comes out of the desert looking like a wild man, right? This was part of the calling that John the Baptist had. He was here to stir it up. And has anybody ever done some spring cleaning around your house? You know, anybody ever done some spring cleaning around a church? Anybody done spring cleaning around a church? I've learned this about a church. If you do spring cleaning around a church, everybody has an opinion about where these plants go. I don't know why every church has plastic plants somewhere in the building. And if you move those plastic plants, it's like you just disturb the force. The force has been out of balance. Why? That plant's been there since Sister So-and-so bought it and put it there, and it's always represented. So that we have this way of just saying, this is the way. John the Baptist basically came looking like a freak with camel eating wild locusts, turning away from the religious norms of his time. Remember, John the Baptist's father was Zechariah. Zechariah was a temple priest, which means he wasn't just a priest. He was a priest in the temple of Jerusalem, the center of spiritual life. He was a made guy. He was a made guy. He came from that elite world, but he rejected that path, and he became a desert priest. He became an ascetic. He went out and rejected the status, the classism, and he came with the message, God is going to shake it up. This was his message of peace. Jesus, on the other hand, although he says the very same thing, repent, the kingdom of God is at hand, Jesus is not taking shots at the power that be, at least not overtly. And this created a tension. John the Baptist says, one's coming after me, and he's going to tear down. He's going to throw into lakes of fire. He's going to hold all of y'all accountable. And when Jesus comes, his message sounds a lot more passive than perhaps the disciples of John the Baptist were expecting. John the Baptist came out pumping Jesus up. Oh, it's on and cracking. You think I'm bad? You think I'm crazy? Wait till Jesus. I'm not even worthy of untying his sandals. I baptize you with water. He's going to baptize you with fire. And as John the Baptist is creating the anticipation, and as the political tension is very much a part of that passage, the political tension of John the Baptist calling out political figures. Remember, John the Baptist is beheaded in Matthew chapter 14 because he calls out the king of the Jews, Herod. In chapter 14, John the Baptist is invited, or not invited, into this wedding. King Herod, the king of the Jews, marries his brother's wife, Herodias. She becomes now the new princess of the Jewish kingdom. And John the Baptist says, hey man, y'all are kind of a little not right. There's something going on here that ain't right. And the Bible says that this upset Herodias, the new bride. And she said, well, actually, her daughter dances in Matthew chapter 5 in the wedding ceremony. And King Herod makes a promise. He makes a vow. He says, today, whatever you ask, I will grant you. Mom pulls Herodias' daughter to the side and says, ask for John the Baptist's head on a platter. Because again, John the Baptist was preaching repentance. But for John the Baptist, repentance and peace on earth meant restitution. It meant disruption of normative behavior that has become toxic or not good. And there is something important to the message of John the Baptist. But it seems that as Jesus begins his ministry and echoes the exact words of John the Baptist, repent for the kingdom of God is at hand, he brings another side to that message of repentance. He says, be reconciled one to another. If somebody slaps you on the cheek, offer them the other cheek. If somebody asks you for a coat, give them two. If they ask you to walk 1 mile, walk two with them. Jesus, the message that Jesus brings does not sound like the same version of repentance that John the Baptist was saying. John the Baptist was going headstrong into the political arena and calling everybody out. Jesus was calling people to a revolution that started from the inside out, just like we sang that song, from the inside out. John the Baptist, in some ways, we can say, was looking for a transformation in his community that very much started from the outside as well, that impacted the outside. What does that have to do with peace this holiday season? What I think about this tension that existed in John the Baptist, the similarities in both John the Baptist, they both were born in miraculous situations. Jesus was born of a virgin, Mary. John the Baptist was born to a barren woman, Elizabeth. Mary, the Virgin Mary, and Elizabeth, they're cousins, they're related. In fact, the Bible says that when both Jesus and John the Baptist were in the womb, and Mary and Elizabeth visit one another, the babies leap with joy. And in fact, it says that the baby, John the Baptist, was filled with the Holy Spirit while in his mother's womb. Wrap your mind around that. It's pretty intense. The angel Gabriel, the same angel, goes to both parents and tells them, hey, This thing that's happening, it's divine. It's of God. And in fact, the angel has the privilege of naming both Jesus and John the Baptist. So there's all these similarities that exist between John and Jesus, yet their messages seem to have a bit of a complementary spirit. And what I mean by complementary spirit is because as I think about the peace that Christ brings, the peace of God on earth, I want to suggest that sometimes the peace of God looks different and has a different expression than one we may be anticipating. In fact, I think that peace has two aspects, and the peace of Christ has two aspects. It has an internal aspect and it has an external aspect. And what I see in the ministry of John the Baptist and Jesus is that they were both speaking about the peace of Christ coming, but they were speaking the peace of Christ in both of its facets. Peace as the external, lack of conflict, if you will. When most people, when you ask them, define peace. What is peace? If someone were to ask you, how would you just define peace? Most people would say something along the lines of peace is the absence of conflict, or peace is the removal of conflict with relationships to other. But there's another aspect of peace, and this is the peace that I believe Jesus was bringing as a complement to the message that John the Baptist was bringing. Jesus was saying there's a peace that lives below the surface. There's an internal peace. There's a peace that has nothing to do with your circumstances. It's a peace that, like an iceberg, is the very foundation of all external peace. Most of us want our situations, when we're in a difficult situation, we want the situation to change quickly. Amen? Anybody agree with that? We pray to God, God, I'm hurting here. I need you to do this yesterday. And Jesus hears that cry from the Jewish community that is saying that is cheering John the Baptist on. Remember, John the Baptist was the one that baptized Jesus. He's the one that heard the sound of God say, "This is my beloved son." The Bible says that when Jesus was baptized, a dove descended and the clouds opened, and all who were present heard the voice of God say, "This is the one. This is the one. This is the real deal." Yet in Matthew chapter 11, I want to read it very briefly, because again, this is a bit of the saga that is happening throughout Matthew's gospel. Throughout Matthew's gospel, there is this ongoing conversation between John the Baptist and Jesus. John the Baptist starts off in Matthew chapter 3 saying, the Messiah's coming, and there's a reckoning. People are going to be tossed into the lakes of fire, the winnowing, everything. And this was prophesied in Isaiah. This is John's introduction. Yet by Matthew chapter 11, the Bible tells us that in verse 2, when John heard in prison what the Messiah was doing, he sent word by his disciples to say to him, "Are you the one that is to come, or shall we wait for another Messiah?" Jesus answered to his disciples, "Go tell John what you hear and what you see. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the poor have good news brought to them. And blessed is everyone who takes no offense at me." John the Baptist was in jail by Matthew 11. And he sends messengers to tell his cousin, Jesus, "Yo, you gonna do anything about this? The scenario is set. I have disciples who are ready for this revolution. We are ready for this peace." And he's perhaps frustrated. And again, this is what I love about reading the Bible, particularly the Gospels, through a synoptic lens. I've talked a little bit about the synoptic importance of the Gospels. The Gospel of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, those three Gospels are basically telling you the same timeline. They're saying it from three different perspectives, three different authors, three different sources, but they're telling you the same thing. The book of John follows a completely different template. There's very little about parables and the Sermon on the Mount. It's a very different gospel. in that sense, it's much more of a mystic gospel. The three synoptic gospels are very historic. They're chronological, and they follow the timeline. And they all add little details about this. John the Baptist is frustrated. Are you the one? Are you the Messiah? When are you going to actually start doing something to bring peace on earth? And Jesus says, you go back and you tell him, blind are receiving their sight. People who are lame are getting up and walking. Lepers who have been ostracized and given a death sentence are being reintegrated into society, into their homes. People who were dead are now resurrecting with new life. The good news is being brought to people. This is the peace that Christ brings on earth, not just an external peace, although he cares about that. The peace that Christ brings is from the inside out, from the inside out. This is powerful. It's powerful to me, and I want to close with a reading from Mark chapter 11. And I want us to think about this as we prepare for Christ coming again. This is what the Advent season is about. It's about us preparing our hearts for the coming of the Christ again. In Mark chapter 11, the Bible tells us that as Jesus finally enters Jerusalem, because again, throughout the ministry of Jesus, Jesus was avoiding going to Jerusalem like the plague. Jesus spent over 90% of his ministry in Judea, in the northern part, in the hill country. Jesus was from Nazareth, which is the Judean, no offense to anybody here if you're from West Virginia, it's the equivalent of West Virginia. It's the hill country. It's the sticks, right? That's why they said you have a Nazarene twang to your voice. You're from the rural part of our community. Jesus was not raised in Jerusalem. Jerusalem was the Rome. Jerusalem was the Los Angeles, the New York, the London. It's where all the center of power was, and Jesus avoided Jerusalem until the very last week of his ministry. Jesus only spends 1 week of his life doing ministry in Jerusalem. And you know what happens on that week? He gets crucified. He finally does what John the Baptist was waiting for. When are you going to go to the temple and reckon? When are you going to go to the political structure and reckon? He did that. In fact, the very first thing he does is he enters on a donkey. He enters on a colt. He goes right to the temple. And what does he do? The very first thing, when we go to our Lenten journey, we'll go through this Lenten journey. And the very first day, it's a theoretical Monday. The Monday, the Passover feast, Jesus goes and he goes right into the money changers on site, like the kids say. Jesus went to Jerusalem and it was on site. He goes right into the temple and he starts overthrowing the table and he says, this is not a place of commerce. This is a place of prayer. This is a place of spiritual renewal. And you've turned it into a den of thieves. And so he starts doing that. But listen to how Jesus enters. If you have your Bibles with you, chapter 11 of Mark, verses 1 says this. I'm going to read the first 6 verses. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethpage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent 2 of his disciples and said to them, go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find there a colt. Somebody say a colt. A colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it to me. And bring it. If anyone says to you, why are you doing this? Just say to them, the Lord has need of it, and the Lord has need of it, and bring it back immediately. They went away and found the colt tied near a door outside the street, and they untied it. Why is that significant in light of the peace that Christ wants to bring us? It's a very small detail that I feel is very, very illustrates something very profound about the peace of Christ that he brings. This passage says that Jesus specifically asks for a colt that has never been ridden, that has never been untied or never been utilized for riding. I'm not sure if anybody here has been around horse culture, equestrian culture. But there's a role. I'm not an equestrian guru or anything like that. I did go to Bible college in Arkansas, and I grew up with a bunch of kids that were all farm kids, right? Iowa, Kansas. I mean, we just spent a lot of time. In fact, the Bible college that we went to, all the men stayed in a barn. It was like a barn, a real barn that was turned into like student housing. So in that space, going from East LA to Arkansas, I learned a little thing or two about horse culture and equestrian. One of the guys that I was very close friends with was from Missouri, and he was a bronco buster. He was in rodeos, and part of what he's a shorter gentleman, but I mean, just tough as nails. I'm telling you, he was probably 5'5", 150 pounds soaking wet, but just a ball of muscle, just a ball of muscle. And he had all these rodeo belt buckles. And he would tell me that one of the hardest jobs on a farm, on a ranch, is breaking colts. He says, it's they're young, they have all this energy, and what you have to do is you have to mount it, and you have to hold on and ride it until it settles down. Anybody that has been around horses knows that if you put that saddle on the colt for the very first time, it's going to buck, and it's not going to stop until it knocks you off. Jesus says to his disciples, I'm coming into Jerusalem. I'm coming to settle the score. I'm coming to bring peace. And as an illustration of that, I want you to grab the most wild, unkept colt. Bring it to me, because I'm going to ride it in tranquility into this city. There's a beautiful image of the peace that Christ brings. You may be surrounded by chaos in your life. You may be in a situation where you say, man, I am going to get bucked, and I'm going to get potentially very hurt. But Jesus says to you, bring me that unridden colt. Bring it to me. And when the Prince of Peace comes upon that, when the Prince of Peace settles onto that colt, whatever that colt may be in your life, you will ride it with calm. In fact, the Bible says that on Palm Sunday, as Jesus entered, they laid palm branches before that unridden colt, and they marveled that Jesus came as the Prince of Peace. I pray this morning that God would bring not just an external peace to your situation, whatever that may be. Where there is conflict, I pray that God would bring resolution, and God would bring a spirit of reconciliation. But I also pray that you grasp that the peace that God brings has not only an external aspect, it has a very, very profound internal facet, that you can be completely at peace in the midst of storms, in the midst of chaos. The Prince of Peace is coming. He's coming again. He's coming again. Let us bring our colts before him. Let's pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for your peace that surpasses all comprehension. Your word says that let our minds be fixed and concentrated on this, God, because you give us a peace that is unshakable. God, we thank you for the hope that this Advent season represents. We thank you for the peace that this season brings. We thank you for the joy and the hope that it brings. Lord, I pray that you would bless us, God, as we take these elements and remember your broken body, God. Remember this first Sunday, the sacrifice, the incarnation, God, of peace, hope, love, and joy that you bring into our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, we are going to take our communion together. This is the first Sunday of the month. The first Sunday of the month is an opportunity for us to gather around the Lord's table and remember that this incarnation, that this divine act of God, the mystery of God coming into earth, was for you and for me. This morning, all who are here are welcomed at this table. Like Keith mentioned at the beginning of this service, you may be an old timer, I say that lovingly, you may have been here for a long time, or this may be the first time that you come. This table is not a table of Union Church, it's a table of the Lord, which means if you're here and you're hungry and you're thirsty for the justice, the peace, the righteousness of Christ, you are welcome to partake with us this morning. I'm going to come down to the altar, and I want to invite you to come and join me in a moment. The scripture tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, Jesus took a piece of bread as he sat with his friends, and he said, "This is my body, broken for you. Every time you gather, remember that the word that became flesh was broken for you and for me." The Bible says that Jesus took a cup, and he poured out wine for his friends. And he said, "This wine represents a new covenant, a new contract with humanity. Now, if you want to come and be forgiven and be redeemed, there is no need to bring any kind of blood sacrifice. I am the blood sacrifice for all of humanity." When we take this bread and we take this cup, we remember that we have been grafted into this beautiful family of God. Each one of us, like we were mentioning in Okinawan culture, in Christian culture, we say to each other, "You're sister so-and-so and brother so-and-so." That's not just religious jargon. We actually mean that. We are family. We are family in Christ. So this morning, as we sing this hymn, "Let Us Break Bread Together," I want to invite you to come out of your seat and come down the center aisle. Our dear sister Lori is going to be serving these elements. We have these individually wrapped communion places. Once you grab this, please feel free to come to your seat, and we'll unwrap it together. Just FYI, they're a little tricky, amen? So let us sing this song together. To invite you to take that top layer off. There's a wafer on there. As you peel back and take this wafer, remember, friends, the body of Christ broken for you. Take and eat. And if you lift up the next little tab, I invite you to take the blood of Christ, this cup representing the redemption of our sins. Drink it. Drink the blood of Christ. Let us pray together. Gracious and loving God, we thank you for the way in which you invite us into a banqueting table. God, we thank you that your banner over us is love. Lord, we thank you that your banner over us is peace and joy and hope. God, we ask that during this Advent season, you would stir us, God, stir us, open us, awaken us to the hope, the love, the joy, the peace that is present with us now, Emmanuel, God with us. Bless these elements, and may we remember forever this covenant that you make with us. In Jesus' name, amen.
I invite the ushers to come forward with the baskets as we prepare for offering. I know we say this every week, that offering is a part of our worship. It's as important, it's as intimate a part of our worship as when we kneel and sing our songs, or when we bring offering, or when we bring our needs before Him. It's just as intimate as that. It's an aspect of how we honor and glorify our God, and honor the fact that we live for His kingdom and not ourselves. We live for His purposes in the world and not for our own purposes. And this is a practical way in which we do that. So join with me as we pray. Lord God, thank you that in this day and age, we have so many ways of giving to you, giving our service to you, sacrificing our needs for you. We have means of giving to so many organizations and to the church, and we have different ways of giving it, whether it's in the basket or through online, cash or credit card. There's just so many ways of bending our lives, bending our purposes towards you. And so we thank you for those myriad ways that we can do that. Would you take, Lord, our meager offerings, no matter what it is we have to give? And we know that you can multiply that like yeast. We know that you can grow it into something so much more beautiful and far beyond what we can even begin to imagine. So we give back to you, Lord, what's already yours. Amen. Let's all rise as we sing the doxology.
Praise God.
Please be seated. So I like to think of our announcement time as kind of, you know, when you have some of our families, I know we have this habit of getting together for Sunday night as a family and sharing that time around a common table with my parents when we lived in Chicago. And, you know, like any family dinner time, there are times where you make announcements and you talk story, and I kind of envision this time as that. And so So I'll read the announcements that we have, and then I'll call for any announcements that maybe didn't make it onto the screen. But this month with Union, on Saturday morning, we have Saturday morning prayer at 8 a.m. That link is available online. That's okay. I love it. I love that I have a little partner. And then Sunday Bible study with Pastor Ken at 9 a.m. That's also, that link is online at our website. So you can find those at our website. The Urban Farm, that's going to be that's being worked on Saturdays from 8:30 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. And then, 8:30 a.m. and then 12:30 p.m. Sunday before or after service. Okay. Any other announcements, Sinho, that we have on screen? Are there any other announcements that need to be made from the floor? Anna?
I wanted to talk about the Christmas Eve program. On Saturday, we're going to be having a half an hour service. It's going to be here at Union Church. It's going to be a half an hour service, and then shortly after, we're going to have lunch. It's 11 or 11:30? 11:30. So show up at 11 to fellowship. Check out the farm. Service will be from 11 to 12, and then we'll have lunch right after. So if you're around, join us, bring your friends, bring your family. Everyone is invited. Also, there's this cute little phone that someone found in the bathroom, ladies' bathroom. If it belongs to you, call me. No, come see me afterwards. And then for the Urban Farm, I want to thank you, you know, those who have come out. You know, we're trying to, you know, just do every other Saturdays and then kind of maintain it on Sundays. And so if you guys want to go outside shortly after and take a look, the produce, we're growing bok choy, mixed lettuce green. They're going to be ready to be harvested in 2 to 3 weeks. So come and be part of the process and help us harvest in the next couple of weeks. Thanks.
Amen. Thanks, Anna. Any other announcements? And Mika-chan, you're always welcome up here whenever you want, okay? You look so pretty in your dress.
Just want to say that the luncheon is going to be, like, really good food. We had somebody donating, like, honey baked ham and prime roast, and, like, it's going to be really good food. So just
wow. So maybe those of you who work, maybe you can arrange for a little longer lunch break that day. Any other announcements? If not, please stand, and I invite Pastor Reuben back up to give us our benediction.
Amen. The benediction time is a time to give one final blessing as we go forth to be the hands and the feet of Jesus. Gracious God, we thank you for the peace that you bring us, God, that is both external, God, but deeply, deeply rooted in an internal peace. God, Lord, help us to have that iceberg peace, God. Help us to have that peace that is unshakable, that lives, God, sometimes unaware of what our circumstances or unperturbed by it, Lord. We thank you for it, Lord. Help us to go forth from this place to not just walk in peace, but to be peacemakers. Your word said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons and daughters of God. May you go forth to be your hands and feet. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you very much for joining us this morning. Please remain standing for our closing hymn, O Come, Emmanuel. Amen. Thank you very much for joining us today. Have a great week. We'll see you next week.